academic feast. So today we are having with us Dr. Sushil. Today's topic for us will be approach to hypophagocytic disorder, something I think at the medicine PG level is something that we are very much, I mean, I'm not sure how many of them will be facing on a daily basis, but definitely as a PG, we'll be encountering many diseases which simulate or might be requiring further knowledge for this for the disease, hypophagocytic disorder. I think Dr. Sushil will be able to do a proper justice with that lecture. And we are very grateful to have you here for us, taking this lecture for us. He is Assistant Professor in the Department of Clinical Hematology, CMC, Vellore. He has done his MBBS, MD and DM from Christian Medical College, Vellore. His current interest and the trials ongoing as of now is on allogeneic transplantation high-risk lymphoma as a co-investigator. He's also a principal investigator in the trial low-cost regimens in myeloma therapy and hematological and immunological profiles in COVID-19. His interest is also in basic science aspects of hematology and immunobiology. So thanks again. And I think for anyone who's missing out on his lectures, please let them know that this lecture will soon be uploaded on our Department of Medicine YouTube website. Any questions or doubts, please feel free to ask, unmute yourself and ask questions, or maybe you can put down your questions in the chat box. Over to you, Sushil. Thanks again.
Yeah. I think at the outset, before I start, I'm happy to take questions anytime. You can disturb me and stop me because, as you know, it's a complex topic, and even the experts in this field are they themselves acknowledge the lacunae in the current knowledge. And what I will attempt here to give you is a broad overview of the concept. And also, hopefully, specifics on the treatment management that is the current day scenario, and specific scenarios that we come across in medicine, which is always confounding, differential diagnoses, which are very close, and those sort of how we go about it. So again, there's lots to talk about. Probably, separate presentations could be made on even a single slide of this. So I think we can, if there's separate doubts that are very extensive, we can take it outside the lecture. But if there's anything that I can clarify during the lecture, I'll be happy to. So my topic today would be hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, otherwise broadly called HLH. While it's very easy to put this down as a statement or a word or a diagnosis, is it really a diagnosis? Is it more of a pattern? Is it more of a syndrome complex? So we will try and approach this problem and get to the bottom of this by the time we end this seminar. What we know essentially just that it's an aggressive life-threatening syndrome of excessive immune activation, frequently affecting the children mainly from birth to 18 months of age, but it's observed, as we all know, all across the board, including even in adults that we see in the wards as of now. The various problems in achieving successful outcome, especially the lack of specificity of the clinical and laboratory findings, not leading to an easy diagnosis in any of the scenarios, and of course the variable clinical presentation that we encounter each time. I'm not going to go into too much of this, but just to remember that no one came across this as a disease, and 1939 Scott and Rob Smith described patients with atypical Hodgkin's disease, which they had described as a histiocytic medullary reticulosis. And when we go back to those case reports, we can sort of see that they most likely were probably cases of HLH. And Farquhar and Claro, however, described the first familial syndrome with similar features across the board, and they labeled it as familial hemophagocytic reticulosis. And finally, only when the Histiocytic Society and Association were set up in the 1980s, early 1980s, 1983, they included the terminologies macrophage activation syndrome and finally HLH. Of course, this is an ongoing change. This is how I will flow through the seminar. Going through the causes, the pathophysiology, clinical manifestations, diagnosis, treatment algorithms, and finally latest advances. Now, I'm not going to try and be regimented in this. It's going to be sort of one flowing into the other. So let's start. A small way to go about this controversy is just this first slide. As we know, currently in CMC and in most of medical literature, we classify HLH as primary or secondary. This itself is a big controversy, as I will go on over the next few slides. But broadly, just to remember that we classify primary HLH as anything with a familial link, essentially a genetic disorder which predisposes to this disease. As you can see, the primary in this classification, primary hemophagocytic syndrome is further classified into familial and immunodeficiency syndromes, of which type 1 to type 5 in the familial hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, of which the perforin gene mutations constitute more. The most common is the perforin gene mutations, which is the type 2 FHL. Immunodeficiency syndromes with primary HLH are very often what we see in the hematology wards, which are basically patients we are trying to transplant or post-transplant. Chediak Higashi, Griscelli type 2, XLP, Viscott-Aldrich, Hermansky-Pudlak, etc. And secondary and reactive hemophagocytic syndrome is probably what more is seen in the medicine wards and the pediatric wards, are essentially classified further into infection-associated and in adults, in adults, malignancy associated and macrophage activation syndrome associated, which is basically HLH when it's associated with an autoimmune disease. Mainly juvenile idiopathic arthritis is a classical one. Of course, we know that it occurs all across the board, SLE, etc. Now, the controversy starts right here. The problem with that diagnosis of primary and secondary was that it never led up to any actual management difference. Finally, we ended up treating primary and secondary essentially the same, probably with the only difference being trying to do transplant in one versus no transplant in the other. But the approach was essentially the same. North American Consortium for Histiocytosis, easy to remember, NACHO. NACHO met up in 2019 and put out a statement where they wanted to change this classification as this, as you can see, familial HLH, malignancy associated HLH, rheumatological conditions with HLH, immune diseases, immune compromised diseases with HLH, treatment related HLH, and HLH disease NOS. NOS is probably what our, you know, standard secondary infections, TB with HLH, all that will fit into HLH NOS. I will go into more detail of this labeling in a subsequent slide. You'll probably realize why I'm doing it. I'm not doing it now. I'll do it a little later so that we get a broader understanding of the subject. But just remember that current, there are two ways of classifying HLH. Probably the more pertinent one would be this NACHO definition. Coming to pathophysiology in more detail, I want you to just look at this slide now. It may look like just a cartoon of how this happens, but just to understand that this is the cytotoxic T cell, essentially the effector cell, either the CTL or the NK cell, which finally affects the cell kill, and the target cell being here. And this is where our immunological synapse occurs, where the CTL attaches to the target cell and dumps the perforin granzymes, opens it up with perforin and dumps the granzymes into the target cell to kill. So here you can see there are various genes required for that process to occur, where the final granzymes are the granule that contains the endocytic vesicle that contains the granule first has to mature with the list factor. It has to polarize to the cell wall with RAB27. It docks at the cell wall with syntaxin. It gets primed with the MUNC13-4 and then finally fuses with the cell wall, degranulates, and then enters the target cell to kill. And each of these steps, why I'm highlighting all these steps is because each of these genes is one of the important familial histiocytosis genes, which finally affect the actual cell kill. This is a cartoon that I thought animation that would help us understand this better. As you can see here, the list, which is the dark blue circle, helps in the vesicle maturation. And finally, the vesicle docking occurs after the maturation occurs with RAB27A. The vesicle priming occurs with MUNC13-4. Vesicle fusion occurs with syntaxin MUNC18-2. Effector function with perforin, which goes, opens up, creates a pore on the target cell wall. And the granzyme, and as you can see, all the granzymes enter and lyse the target cell. Now, this perforin is found in lytic granules of both natural killer cells and cytotoxic T cells. The cytotoxic T cells, as you know, are labeled with CD8 positivity compared to the CD4 helper cells. So these CD8 cytotoxic T cells are often the main cause for the effector function or effector arm of the HLH pathophysiology. Yeah, the perforin, it's important to understand it's not as easy as it goes and attaches to the cell wall and then causes a hole to be formed. It actually oligomerizes with the membrane activation complex, which is, as you remember, the C6-9 complement proteins joining to form the membrane activation complex. And this actually oligomerizes with the membrane of the target cell, forming a channel. Now, there are actually two, I don't want to go into too much detail. Please stop me if I'm, boring you to death. But essentially, just to remember that there are two hypotheses of how this happens. I won't go into too much detail, but as you can see here, one hypothesis is where in a single receptor model, where the membrane attack complex binds to the target cell, it anchors, and then the perforin comes and joins that to form this MACPF, that is the membrane attack complex perforin moiety, and then this goes on to form the pore, and then the pore opens up after forming an initial pre-pore. Whereas the other model is where it does not actually require the membrane activation complex, therefore just directly binds to the cell wall. Similarly to the perfringolysin O model actually is what is used to describe this. It directly, without a MAC joining into the moiety, it directly causes the pore formation on the target cell. Now, what is the problem with this beautifully acting mechanism, which is naturally occurring every day, every second in our body? The problem with any of these, which I mentioned so far, causes the failure to kill the target cell. And this realizes in an uncontrolled expansion of the cytotoxic T cells, because the antigen presenting cells are continuingly to present the antigen, which has not been lysed, to those T cells. And they undergo an uncontrolled expansion with the help of various cytokines, especially with the release of interferon gamma from those cytotoxic T cells. And this leads to an uncontrolled activation of macrophages, and this leads to the clinical picture of HLH. Now, I've simplified this a bit in this animation, which I've modified from online. As you can see, this is how a virus-infected cell presents, in the tissue. The antigen-presenting cells present the antigen to the cytotoxic T cells. And however, because of ineffective cell kill, it continues to produce cytokines but does not kill the infected cells. And therefore, there is a further presentation of these antigens and further recruitment of cytotoxic T cells, expansion, which is often even clonal, especially of the CD8 positive, HLA-DR positive cohort, which I will go to down the line. This has been extensively shown in mouse models and in murine models and in flow cytometric analysis and cytokine arrays across the board. Now, I think it's fairly evident that this is there is no doubt in the pathophysiology in terms of the common pathway of HLH. The role of interferon gamma, I'm just going to show you one mouse study, which was sort of landmark in this. If I don't know whether people are interested in this or not, but I find it interesting. Where you can see here the wild type model and the perforin deleted model. Mouse, both of these are mice models, and you can see that the interferon gamma levels after a normal exposure to a LCMV infection, that's an infection that they use, the leukocoriomeningitic virus infection. You can see the interferon gamma levels significantly higher in the mice who are perforin mutated or deleted rather. This is actually borne out in all across the board in these mice. Further, another interesting slide from this study was from another study that was more recent, was a perforin deficient mice with HLH having a normal amount of actual dendritic cells. But what they found was, again, this significant increase in the interferon gamma compared to the wild type when they were exposed to an LCMV infection. And in addition, they found that these CD11C positive cells were significantly higher in this group of cells, in this group of mice which had perforin gene mutation. I'll come to the significance of this down the line. Now, going on to more of how these diseases present, I think this will be more relevant to pediatricians. So I'll skip over these slides relatively fast, but it's important that we just get an understanding of these diseases, because essentially in hematology, this is what we look for. I mean, we need to identify patients, because doing next-gen sequencing studies often is a matter of around 2 weeks to 4 weeks, anywhere between that, to get our answer on the gene panel. So identifying these syndromes through other ways often helps us in the further management of these patients. So as I mentioned, FHL 1 to 5 are caused by various genes which are part of that vesicle docking, priming, maturation, and fusion process of the at the cytotoxic T cell of slash NK cell level. And Chediakigashi and Griscilla were the others, which are also familial, which I had mentioned previously. Familial HLH was named after Farquhar, who, as you remember, had initially identified the first familial case. They are usually autosomal recessive, usually evident within the first year. And it's usually difficult to miss, because they present with this overwhelming cytokine release syndrome without any evidence of infection. However, in our country, we still have a lag in diagnosis of these cases. Often between 4 to 6 months is the median time to diagnosis of a familial histiocytosis as per the Indian data. I'm going to skip through these slides relatively fast, just to say that, you know, these are all studies. I'll stay on this slide a little more, because this is the most common of the familial histiocytosis, perforin 1 gene mutation. Just remember that between the perforin and monk, and the next one, this monk 13-4, this constitutes around 70% of all familial histiocytosis cases. Essentially, FHL2 and FHL3 combining to form around 70% of the total FHL cases. Going on to FHL4, which was a syntaxin mutation. Again, I'll skip through this also. I was considering that there might be some pediatricians here. If there are any, they can stop me and we can go into more detail. Among 18-2 is the mutation that is responsible for FHL5, and as you know, that it, if you remember from the previous slide, it was the one that required the docking and fusion process. Chediakigashi syndrome, a few of you registrars who are listening may have recalled seeing some patients when they were in their hemat rotation with the silvery hair that are admitted because of an infection that goes on. It's a classical picture of both Chediakigashi and Griscilla type 2, where they have light compression, light complexions, silvery hair, and characteristic peripheral neuron disease. And the infections are very common because of the inability to phagocytose. And the LIST gene, which was the one that was, if you remember, responsible for the initial maturation of the vesicle, is the defective gene in this disease. Type 2 Griscilla is the other very similar presentation with silvery hair, light skin. And here again, the NK cells and CTL show an impaired granulation because of the RAB27A mutation, which renders the vesicles unable to dock on the cell wall. XLP, the last one that I'd probably look at in FHL, is essentially characterized by a gross hypogammaglobulinemia and a lymphoproliferation, which is why it's called X-linked lymphoproliferative disorder. SLAM-associated protein is the mutated SLAM-associated protein is the predominant reason for this disease. If you can see the slide, SH2 over here, and SAP both associate with the protein kinase, and in the absence of this, this allows the SHP1, SHP2, SHP, all these cell moieties so it actually inhibits the SHP1, SHP2, and therefore in the healthy patient, there is an active lysis of that target cell. However, there's no inhibition of the NK cell essentially. However, in this, when there is a mutation of the SH2 moiety, these proteins, the SHP1, SHP2, SHP and SHP1, bind on to the intracellular part of the receptor on the NK cell, allowing the and thus rendering the NK cell unable to kill the target cell, often the EBV infected B cell. And now we'll go on to something that is a little more pertinent, infection and HLH as a whole. So in 1979, Rizdal et al. Had described around 19 patients as a case series with evidence of HLH and a viral infection after transplantation. And later it was shown that most of the patients had no evidence of an immune dysfunction before developing this. So because of that, they decided to label it as initially a viral associated hemophagocytic syndrome, sort of a broad term. And then this further was broadened further to infection associated hemophagocytic syndrome. And as of now, current knowledge, there are so many infections that are well known to, I've just given a brief list of the most common, but as you know, literally any infection can go on, especially in certain, ideal settings can go on to produce a HLH picture. I think of these, we would have seen infections of any of these probably go on to cause HLH in our setting. Of course, I think the more common ones that is seen in the medicine wards are often the viral and of course tuberculosis. So the role of macrophages in HLH and sepsis, something that I think is important that we remember, CD163 is the macrophage, monocyte macrophage activate marker, cell surface marker. And in fact, it is previously it used to be one of the ideal immunohistochemistry markers that was used in the diagnosis of tissue HLH. And now even the soluble CD163, as you all know, is being done in CMC as of now. And it's while it has not yet entered the diagnostic criteria for HLH, it is probably very likely to enter in one of the upcoming revisions. But as of now, it is not one of the criteria, but it is one of the potential biomarkers for diagnosis of HLH. As you can see in these slides, the significant amount of CD160, in sepsis and in the control population, the CD163 deposition, and in you can see that there's obviously a difficulty in separating sepsis from HLH in this setting, which is why we will go on to cytokine syndromes a little beyond this. But just keep this in mind that, you know, HLH and sepsis are often considered part of a spectrum disorder, or even considered completely different in terms of their etiologies based on current data. I'll just one brief note about EBV and HLH. I think we all know that EBV is the most common viral trigger, most common infectious trigger overall, and definitely the most common viral trigger HLH overall. It carries the worst among all the viral triggers. It carries around 73% mortality in one case series. This is a case series that was done when the HLH 94 protocol was, of course, there. And incidence is highest in the East Asian countries, probably due to what they think is a more virulent endemic strain. This is all hypothesis. And obviously, the EBV has also can go on to stimulate a B-cell lymphoproliferative disorder, which underlines the HLH presentation. So, yeah, a small note on macrophage activation syndrome before we dive deeper. The first description of this disorder was as early as 1970s, but it was first used in literature in 1992, occurring both in adults and children with autoimmune syndromes, characterized by the typical syndrome complex that we are all aware of. It is most commonly used to refer to an HLH or HLH-like syndrome occurring in the context of a rheumatological disorder. The strongest association is with systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Though we know that it can occur with anything, including SLE and adult onset stills being the classical adult disease, being the classical autoimmune disease we see in adults. A small list of the, I've shown this before, but just for an eyeball of the list of diseases that can predispose to MAS. And is there an overlap between FHLH and RHLH is often the contention, you know, what is the chicken, what is the egg? And the problem in this is that, you know, the thing that is added to the confusion is that adult onset HLH was often considered, it cannot be a genetic disease because the patient has presented so late. But in multiple studies across the countries, as you can see in this, I've just shown you one study that was published in Rheumatologic Arthritis 2014, where they looked at these patients with adult onset HLH. Labeled as essentially macrophage activation, and they did NGS panels to look for genes responsible for HLH. Five showed variants in classical known genes, that as you can see here in the second column, these classically known genes of in the HLH stimulation pathway were found to be defective. And there were multiple compound heterozygotes that were also found. And after doing computer modeling of these variants, they found that all of them finally impacted the HLH pathway. And in that sense, while you know that will not, because they could be just genetic polymorphisms also. In fact, even the perforin gene mutation is supposed to be heterozygous polymorphism in around 4% of the general population. So while this further just served to, you know, cause confusion in, you know, whether this should be labeled as a genetic HLH or a rheumatoid or, you know, acquired HLH in that sense of the term. So which is why the current recommendation is to perform genetic analysis on all patients, adult or pediatric, who are suspected or confirmed to have HLH. And that is where we stand. Data is still pouring in, and I'll show you a brief picture of it. Coming to cytokine storms in general, as we know, fever, I think now, especially now with the current flavor of the year, almost COVID, we know the problem with cytokine storms. And fever is induced by the overproduction of IL-1, pancytopenia consequence of TNF-alpha and interferon gamma. The activated macrophages go on to secrete ferritin actively. Macrophages also secrete for other acute inflammatory biomarkers like plasminogen activator, consuming plasma fibrinogen leading to elevated D-dimers. Activated lymphocytes secrete soluble CD25 infiltrating liver and CNS. Proliferation of macrophages expressing the macrophage activation marker CD163 in the marrow and lymphoid tissue leads to hemophagocytosis. So this is what has been suggested as a sort of spectrum of cytokine-induced disease, ranging from the normal response to infection, sort of the blue end of the spectrum, going on to a genetic HLH on the red. Now, this is a very odd spectrum, as you can understand, because, you know, I've included SIRS, sepsis, macrophage activation, acquired HLH, and genetic HLH all in one spectrum. We'll go into more detail why. A brief stop at our diagnostic criteria. I think everyone is familiar at this among us, so I won't spend too much time on this. This is the revised diagnostic guidelines for HLH based on the HLH 2004 criteria. I'm just going to hit on the important points, just two things. Just remember that a molecular diagnosis, I want you to remember that this criteria is only two. Though we look at all these, it's only these two, essentially. If you have a molecular diagnosis consistent with HLH, that is, if one of your gene panel shows a marker, you're not going to do anything further. That's enough for you to diagnose HLH, irrespective of anything. The second one is your diagnostic. So only because, you know, we don't have these ready-made diagnoses, unless the patient gets diagnosed outside and comes to us, we often have to go through this. And these are further subdivided into initial diagnostic criteria and the new diagnostic criteria, of which the new are lower absent NK cell activity, ferritin, and soluble CD25. Whereas the other five are classical clinical and lab parameters that we look for. And we know that five out of these eight are enough to suggest HLH for our patients. I thought I'll not go too much into NK cell activity, but yeah, I'll leave that for, since in view of time. Just remember a few comments on this diagnostic criteria. If the bone marrow sample is not conclusive, material may be obtained from other organs, especially liver biopsies may be helpful, especially tissue biopsies of any other kind can also be helpful, sometimes skin. The following findings may also provide supportive evidence, especially the spinal fluid. Now, the CNS is a special interest in HLH because though it is a sanctuary site in many other lymphocytic lymphoproliferative disorders, in HLH, it's often the among the first organ systems to get involved beyond the blood. And the liver and CNS are often very commonly affected in HLH. And as we know that it constitutes, it therefore becomes part of the criteria to do CSF analysis in those scenarios. This is just a few slides to show pictures of the actual hemophagocytosis that is seen on bone marrow examinations. Now, a big question. Is HLH a pattern or a disease? Now, for this, I will go back to the Nacho group. And you will see that, you know, I talked a lot about, you know, how clarity has been reached in terms of pathophysiology. Now, while that is true, it doesn't mean that clarity has been reached in terms of our conception of HLH overall. And it's important to realize that not all patients who display HLH pattern will benefit from immunosuppression. And so, therefore, to clarify this thinking, the Nacho group further divided the disease into HLH syndrome, HLH disease, and HLH disease mimics. I'll just briefly clarify what these are. HLH syndrome is very simple. It's if you diagnose them based on the HLH 2004 criteria. Now, if you have HLH syndrome with a distinctive immune active, where you have established that immune activation score, now that, while that's a broad term, essentially anyone who you feel will benefit from immediate immunosuppression in that scenario, because you feel that the immune activation is the core of the disease, that patient gets classified into HLH disease. HLH disease mimic is someone who may not directly benefit from the immune modulation. Not that this says that you should not use immunomodulation in this patient, but it's sort of someone who says that you may not benefit from a direct immunomodulation. Now, to further illustrate, actually, we had gone through this in detail. And so the authors themselves have given a sort of example, because obviously this is not intuitive to understand what they mean. It sounds like sort of jargon. And so they've given an example. I don't know if this will help you, but it helped us in our understanding. So essentially, HLH syndrome, there's no confusion on how we diagnose it, at least because it's a very simple checking off of boxes on the diagnostic criteria. But disease and disease mimics. So an example that they give is, imagine if someone has an HLH syndrome and we identify a genetic disorder, one of the HLH genes comes positive, or we find that the patient has a rheumatological condition underlying. In that sort of scenario, we would label that patient as an HLH disease. Now, the same patient who has HLH syndrome, if we find that the patient has, say, a malignancy trigger, so a patient turns out to have a T-cell lymphoma, or the patient turns out to have disseminated HSV infection, is what they use as their example. In that scenario, you know, while it may not directly benefit from an immune modulation, we may still use a course of steroids in that scenario, but it does not. It's obviously a disease where you have to treat the underlying disorder rather than treating the HLH as a syndrome and as a disease itself per se. So I think that was a very helpful clarification that the Nacho group introduced to the overall picture. And actually, Michael B. Jordan, there are many videos of him talking about how they conceptualized this. And they've actually given us one small cartoon to also help us. So as you can see, in this one diagram, they've crystallized what they were trying to make in terms of their whether it is a pattern or a disease HLH sort of clarity. So form frusti, I think the Latin term for anything that is not yet reached its full manifestation. So that is essentially on the extreme right. But once you reach disease, actual HLH syndrome, we fit into this entire sort of teardrop that they've drawn here. Now, in this teardrop, you can put them into various aspects. You can label them as an FHLH, RHLH, an iatrogenic HLH, HLH with immune compromise, malignancy-associated HLH. All these, some of them having overlap with each other, as we have shown previously. But only a few of them will be labeled as HLH diseases. And especially in these two diseases, the HLH with immune compromise, the HLH with malignancy associated, and a significant amount of the HLH NOS will fall into HLH disease mimics, which means that our treatment does not mean that we straight away jump into immunosuppression. We also have to take care of the underlying etiology per se. I hope that was clear. I think it's an important part of the presentation that my targets of this presentation to highlight so that people get an understanding of what HLH is rather than just, follow criteria. So, coming on to MAS, macrophage activation syndrome, the rheumatologists have gone in a direction for themselves to try and identify this irrespective of the HLH criteria. And they have succeeded in setting up this H score. Which has been shown in two trials at least to be a little more having higher sensitivity for the diagnosis of RHLH. I'm not going to dwell too much. This is an online, this is directly from the website. You can see that multiple parameters are what they use, including clinical parameters, laboratory parameters, as seen here, and even bone marrow pathology. And finally, you reach an age score, and that gives you a probability of having HS based on a percentage. Now, the best cutoff for the age score was found, many studies showing many things, but this was validated on a pediatric cohort. And in an adult cohort, they said that an even lower score was sometimes sensitive. But the article has said that 169 corresponded to a sensitivity of around 93% with a specificity of 86% and accurate classification of around 90% of the patients. So I think that's reasonably good for a diagnostic system. Yeah, so and this is another one, especially MAS in the setting of systemic juvenile idiopathic arthritis, they said that this criteria per se would probably be one of the best ways to diagnose. Going on to treatment, which is the second last part of this presentation, I hope I'm not boring everyone, but the immediate aim is to suppress overwhelming inflammation and immune activation. I think that should be very clear in our understanding before we go into the specifics. In 1991, the Histiocyte Society developed the HLH-94 treatment protocol. This significantly improved survival in pediatric populations. And in 2002, they validated their protocol, showing an overall survival rate of around 80% of patients subsequently. In 2002, there was a study that was published in the patients that subsequently underwent HSCT. And this further cemented the importance of hematopoietic stem cell transplantation in this group, because around 80% of them had survived in the group that managed to reach HSCT. But unfortunately, as we know, the crux is often reaching HSCT. Because there's a big difference, there's a sort of big slip between the cup and the lip when it comes to that, especially at the initial starting of the treatment and initial presentation, because often there is a delay and the patients often come too sick to give the full protocol, or we have to modify the protocol, or they tend to succumb during the protocol. So, yeah. One important thing I think we should remember, I think if people ask us, is though in CMC we broadly advocate the HLH 2004 protocol, the current recommendations in most guidelines are the actually individualized HLH 94 protocols. It's not a very big difference, but it's something that I think we should state upfront. There are only two big differences. I mean, there are very few minor differences, but the big differences are in HLH 2004 protocol, even in the first initial therapy weeks, that is the first 3 weeks, we give off cyclosporin, whereas in 94, there is no cyclosporin in the first 3 weeks. And the second difference is when you're giving the intrathecal therapy, while it's only methotrexate in HLH 94, we also add steroids to the intrathecal therapy in 2004. Now, the 2004 protocol was validated, and then the details were published actually in 2017 in Blood, and they did not show a benefit in outcomes, but they did not show, I mean, it was non-inferior, but they definitely did not show benefit. And that probably is why many societies still recommend a sort of modified 94 protocol. But oftentimes, you know, the modification, especially in patients, will be that you add the cyclosporin earlier. Because sometimes they are too sick to give high-dose etoposide, which is often the crux of the therapy. They are too septic, they are too on the border to give them cytotoxic therapy. So we tend to give push cyclosporin on them. And so therefore, in CMC, our department at least has taken an active decision to use the HLS 2004 protocol. And in our experience, we have found not many problems with cyclosporin. Of course, it's important to remember, I mean, these are the details of the protocol. I don't want to, you know, bore you too much with that. But important that, you know, the HSCT can be done anywhere between once we complete the initial therapy and anywhere in the continuation therapy if it is indicated. That is in the setting of a familial HLH or a patient that we feel is going on into recurrent HLH, even though we don't find any gene mutations. So, the dose modifications, I think, are important to remember that renal and hepatic dysfunctions often throw a spanner in the works in terms of actually administering the protocol. And of course, the presence of an active infection on board or coexisting with an underlying HLH further complicates the entire picture. Renal dysfunction, especially cyclosporin, is advised to be held in patients with a creatinine clearance less than 50, though that is often not possible. And the initial doses of etoposide are advised to be reduced in patients where poor prognosis is expected and where age is more than 75 and poor performance statuses are seen. So this is a small algorithm that we can follow. This is not the standard, but just something that will give us a sort of idea. This was published in a recent Cancer Control Journal article, where you can see the initial therapy for infectious disease and the disease gets controlled. In the non-responder, we give the initial 8-week chemotherapy. This is in infection-associated HLH. And if then this patient is subsequently identified to have familial HLH or a non-familial HLH with the genes that are possibly impacting the HLH pathway, we continue chemotherapy until a hematopoietic stem cell transplant. And in the non-HLH responders, treatment can be discontinued after the initial 8-week chemotherapies. After they have responded. But if it relapses, then we again resume therapy and then go on to a HSCT. this is sort of what they have advised. This is a small stratified treatment guideline that is available online. It's not, though it appears confusing, it's not really too confusing. Essentially, just simplifying it into, once the diagnosis is made, if the family history is positive, it goes into HLH 2004 and hematopoietic stem cell transplant. If there is a negative family history, we look for underlying conditions present, all those which I've listed in the previous slides. And most of them end up with HSCT, except those with secondary immune defects, where we treat underlying infections. There's no response, we give them, keep them on cyclosporin dexa. If there's no response to that, then we go on to HLH 2004 and then decide whether we take them up for transplant or not, if they are fit. Other infections pretty much follow the same line. Of course, patients with the malignancies which are setting off HLH, like T-cell lymphomas and a few other solid organ malignancies, can be treated with the primary chemotherapy to control their cancer, and an HLH 2004 protocol which can be modified to control the HLH at presentation. So, yeah. The current approach to FHL is, again, just to say that we have to identify, these are, some of these tests are not being done in CMC right now, and probably not done in many of the centers that are in the country. Essentially, the core test that I want you to all to look at is this panel here, which says mutation analysis, which is now quite widely available with next generation sequencing platforms now becoming commercially viable for Indian patients. Around anywhere between 6,000 to 15,000 rupees for various NGS panels for familial HLH screening. And if these identify any of these, they straight away continue, make the diagnosis for us, and then subsequently allow us to treat. Important to know that after treatment, when there is reactivation or there's what we call a relapse, we can intensify treatment, maybe start from week two, even though we have gone on to week six or eight. But oftentimes this leads on to a poor prognosis, which I will go on to in more detail. Specific treatment notes that we should remember is that any HLH triggered by leishmaniasis can be treated often solely with amphotericin. It's one of the clear indications for where HLH 2004 protocol need not be given in an infection setting. Etoposide is very crucial for an EBV associated HLH, especially which inhibits here because of the activated T cell population in and the EBV DNA in the infected cells. Etoposide functions against both of those two arms of the etiology in EBV associated HLH. I think the rest we've all gone through. The HSCT is the best overall outcome among all single treatment modalities across all patient populations. Salvage therapies, just two more slides on salvage therapies. Essentially, cyclosporin, DEP, alemtuzumab, and anakinra are all in the works, studies to be used. Just to show that of these two, probably alemtuzumab, definitely, though it's extremely costly and its availability in India is really not available in India. It has been shown to be effective with around of a group of 22 patients, around 14 of them had gone into PR with just alemtuzumab injections. DP, which is essentially a chemotherapy regimen a little more intensive than the HLH protocol, which used lipodox and etoposide for a period of around a month to 2 months. As you can see here, 34 patients, of which a significant majority of them had gone into either CR or PR with DEP. And in our experience also, we have found that DEP, especially in the relapse setting, is quite effective. So, yeah, I think in macrophage activation syndrome, it's important that the applicability of the HLH 2004 protocol to the adult populations itself is not fully established. In fact, adult HLH in the setting, if you even now do a medline search of adult HLH studies in adult HLH more than, say, 15 to 20 years ago, you will not find all, there are literally no studies beyond 15 to 20 years ago. All the studies that are published are within the last 15 years, in fact. And most of the applicability of these protocols are in question. But as a broad guideline, it is a very useful tool to use HLH 2004 protocol. However, in patients with rheumatological diseases, it's important to understand that the core is immunosuppression here. And so hitting with high-dose steroids, elimination of triggers, supportive measures, and second-line therapies, which include IVIG and cyclosporin, are all fine. So coming to the last segment is actually recent advances. Essentially, I'm going to focus on cytokine pattern testing. We know that actually both the TH1 and TH2 cytokines, when tested, have shown classical profiles in HLH. The pattern is of a significant increase in interferon gamma, IL-10, combined with a slightly increased level of IL-6, which is specific for childhood HLH. Now, in patients with bacterial sepsis, there's a different cytokine pattern. Now, I'll go to that in the next slide. But it's an interesting study that was published in Blood just, a week or 2 weeks ago, which I'll show you in the next slide. This is the study that was published. This was April 29th, yes. So in early sepsis, they compared HLH with early sepsis, and they were looking at T-cell activation profiles to distinguish them. And what they found was actually that this particular CD38 positive HLA-DR positive T cell clonally expanded in the HLH group versus the early sepsis immune response group. This is an elegant study actually that an editorial was also written for. And I'm just going to show you the final table because there's so many tables in the study. I don't want to bore you with them. But as you can see here, the T cell activation parameters distinguishing patients with HLH and sepsis, the CD8 positive, that is the cytotoxic T cell, which had a CD38 positive flow cytometric marker and HLA-DR CD38 high and HLA-DR positive on the flow cytometry. This had the highest sensitivity, specificity, and very high positive negative predictive ratios and likelihood ratio of around 9 for distinguishing patients with HLH and sepsis. Something that I thought is very interesting for us to, in fact, study further, especially since we have enough of these conundrums, clinical conundrums, both in our ICUs and in our wards. So, yeah. I'll end with this, just the entity of cytokine release syndrome. Now, initially, cytokine release syndrome was classically associated with iatrogenic, constituted part of the iatrogenic HLH spectrum, essentially with multiple monoclonal antibodies, which especially the bispecific antibodies for leukemia, which directly linked up T cells with the effector cell with the target cell. And of course, with CAR T cell entry, this is what was often seen on from the day 0 to day 10 onwards, but usually within the first 5 days. And you can see here the soaring IL-6 levels for which this became almost classical as on a laboratory parameter. And tocilizumab was therefore the recommendation for anything between grade 2 to grade 4 cytokine release syndrome. It's something that in CMC, we've not started using CAR T cells, but we have used a few bispecific antibodies, and we have used multiple of those. With the rituximab and all, we have not really seen too much of CRS, but the bispecific antibodies and haploidentical transplant are where our CRS syndromes are very common. I don't know whether the registrars who have come to hematology so far are remember that those first 4 days before the cyclophosphamide comes in a haploidentical transplant is where the patient's fever is sitting at 104, 105, and the patient is actively chilling, and that is where these IL-6 patterns are shown. So my last slide will be this, while this is heavily controversial. This is essentially something that, since everyone is looking into tocilizumab in COVID, it's important to remember that we don't see IL-6 levels anywhere near what we see in CRS, that is the iatrogenic CRS that I showed previously. It's much less, almost to a magnitude less. But just to remember that the IL-6 has two methods of signaling. So the standard IL-6 molecule, has a classical receptor signaling, which is the middle of these pictures. You can see this is actually impacting the acute phase response, humoral immunity, it impacts proliferative survival, epithelial regeneration. And this is where the IL-6 receptor goes and attaches to the GP130 receptor, IL-6R, on the target cell, usually the hepatocytes and other things. Now, in the setting of sepsis or in the setting of inflammation, ADAM13 actually cleaves these receptors. The IL-6R receptors get cleaved off the cell surface, And they are essentially, that is what is the soluble IL-6R. And these IL-6 IL-6 molecules go and bind on to these soluble IL-6R. And these moieties subsequently go on to bind the IL-6 receptor in the cells that are now expressed in multiple, all over the body, including endothelium, etc. And these constitute the trans signaling. Now, so therefore, often what they say is that the IL-6 trans signaling is the thing that that constitutes the leukocyte trafficking, the T-cell proliferation, tissue remodeling, repair, cell proliferation, fevers, all these are from this. So they are trying to say that if you inhibit only the trans signaling and then, you know, the leave the classical signaling, it might be something that is a future in the treatment of CRS in general. But as of now, tocilizumab is a broad receptor blocker, and it blocks soluble IL-6R, it blocks membrane IL-6R, and therefore blocks both trans signaling and classical IL-6 receptor signaling. Important to remember, therefore, that once you give tocilizumab, the level of IL-6 actually in the body goes up, because the receptors that bind and remove the and metabolize the IL-6 are actually being blocked by tocilizumab. And so what you see in patients with on tocilizumab is actually a significant jump in the IL-6 levels after the tocilizumab in COVID. And I think I'll end with this slide, which is a review article from NEJM, of course, which talked about the various triggers, including COVID, of course, iatrogenic, monogenic, then, of course, the driver cells themselves getting activated. An immune hyperactivation process that we talked about, which leads to the cytokine storm, leading to the various elevated levels of interleukins and TNF-alpha and interferon gamma. And this going on to further prolong activations of various signaling pathways, which can be inhibited by steroids, JAK inhibitors, and even CNIs, calcineurin inhibitors and mTOR inhibitors, and like sirolimus. And therefore, the collateral damage may putatively be inhibited by use of any of these drugs. JAK inhibitors like ruxolitinib have been suggested. And so that is where the future is sort of in this disease. But I hope I've given you a broad outline of the complexities in HLH. And so, you know, while it might be easy to say HLH as a diagnosis, it should not be the basket diagnosis that we put everyone into. It's important that that's just a step in the diagnostic process and the management, more importantly, the management process, so that we finally identify whether this patient requires immunosuppressive therapy, whether the patient requires infection or trigger control therapy, or the patient requires rapid identification of underlying rheumatological or malignant conditions. These are what should be the focus in the initial stage. And regarding treatment, I think I don't know whether it'll be too important, because it may not be, I mean, I don't think that in general medicine, it will be given too much. But it's important to have a perspective, especially in the counseling of patients and in the overall prognostic, talking to patients about prognosis when we have a patient with us. And if there's any doubts, I'm happy to take them.
Thanks, Sushil. I think that fairly covered a very, a very large topic, but a very short time. And I think it was elaborate, but I think at the same time, it was very, very specific. I think I just want to highlight on the topic, your talk on the teardrop representation of the spectrum, the syndromic representation of the multiple types of HLH and the treatment protocols, and also the cytokine storm per se. There are some questions in the chat box. If you can see, Sushil, I think there's one question, four or five questions. One is, how would a patient suffering from HLH typically present? What would be the course of management? When should we suspect there is HLH in patients presenting to outpatient?
Sorry, I, Anju, I'm just looking at the question. Just a second.
The first question, how would a patient suffering from HLH typically present? What would be the course of management? When should we suspect there's HLH in patient presenting to OPD?
I think you can clearly cover that. Yeah, HLH, I think it's important that we realize that HLH is not, it's usually, let me not put it, you know, very broadly, because I can't say right now, especially in the current scenario when OPDs are at a crunch. Now, when you have fever that is high grade, if you just look at the 2004 criteria, that should sort out this question. But it's important to remember that, you know, the HLH 2004 criteria is not a Bible. It is a guidance. So if you have a patient with a non-remitting high-grade fever with high inflammatory parameters, no infection active, or an infection active that is not settling despite treatment, or you have an underlying malignancy which has an unexplained fever, which is not a low-grade fever like a B symptom, or you have a rheumatological condition, syndrome complex with a rheumatological condition with high-grade fever, the diagnosis that actually needs to be considered, because the whole point is missing out the diagnosis till later. If the diagnosis is considered, in general, it gets made. So if the diagnosis is kept in mind in any patient who has a non-remitting fever with enough triggers, all the triggers that we have gone through, I think it's easy to make I won't say it's easy to, you know, diagnose. It's easy to suspect that patient. Of course, diagnosis is an entire ballgame. And I think as far as I can make out, I have never diagnosed a patient of HLH on an OPD basis. If I have suspected anything, I've always admitted that patient. And then because the patient will require multiple tests, marrow, and may even require urgent therapy. So I would always advise admission from an IP basis because of the background testing and investigations that will be required.
Thanks, Sushil. I think that answers it. Next question was, what's the difference between 2004 criteria and AIDS score?
Oh, it's I think everyone knows the HLH criteria. So I don't think the H score is something that you need to memorize. The 2004 criteria is quite good to memorize. Even from an exam point of view, it's good. But even from, I think in general medicine, it's important to have that criteria in mind. But let me just show you the, sorry, just a second.
I can share the slide, that's good.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. Is that seen?
No, not yet. Yeah, it's coming.
Ah.
Yes.
Yeah, so I'll read it out. I think it's too small, but essentially known underlying immunosuppression, maximum temperature, hepatomegaly, splenomegaly, lower hemoglobin levels, lower leukocyte counts, lower platelet counts, higher ferritin levels, higher triglyceride levels, low fibrinogen levels, higher SGOT, SGPT, and hemophagocytosis features on aspirate. All this gets entered into a computer algorithm. And then the computer calculates a score. It's a complex scoring. Obviously, it's not something that you're going to be doing bedside. So, but there are enough online tools available. And I think even QXC has one that is readily available. And this gives you a head score. And that head score gives you a probability of having HS. And I think if you use anywhere between 140 to 169, I mean, there are studies that have cutoff values for each thing. But and then you finally get, you get an answer for yourself that tells you the probability of having HS. Now you have to put this into context. I want to caution against. See, what I firstly want to caution against is blindly dumping diagnosis of HLH just based on scoring. As you know, as I was just showing you, any patient with sepsis is going to have a high H score. Doesn't mean that they have HLH. What I'm trying to say is that we have to keep everything in mind, and then a H score will always add to that diagnostic probability. And I think that approach is what these protocols and these diagnostic criteria help us in. Especially the HLH 2004 criteria helps us in that to a great extent, because it then allows us to identify the syndrome. And once we identify the syndrome, it allows us to identify whether the patient has disease or disease-like. This is a criteria that is specific for macrophage activation. And, we don't use it too much in our institution, but of course, rheumatology does use it. And it has been shown to be more effective in those settings, especially in the macrophage activation setting for identifying HLH, identifying macrophage activation.
Sure, thank you. There's one more question. How to treat a relapsed EBV and related HLH?
Sorry, let me chat.
How to treat a relapsed EBV and CME infection related HLH in a patient who is not transplant eligible?
So I think it's a very good question, and we have great problems with this. Now, first thing is always to remember that this patient that you're labeling as an EBV CMV infection with HLH very likely has an underlying familial HLH also. Okay, as I mentioned before, it just because you have identified EBV on this patient, please go ahead and do the NGS. Make sure that the patient doesn't have a genetic disease underlying. That is point one. Point two is the treatment for EBV and CMV specific treatments have to be initiated also. It is not only the HLH 2004 protocol. As I mentioned before, the trigger has to be treated. EBV has to be treated with therapies including rituximab, IVIG can also be considered. CMV also has to be treated with specific therapies, including ganciclovir, sidofovir, foscarnet, etc. All these antivirals have to be initiated. In that setting, if they are still undergoing HLH, which is what most of our patients, when we see, that's what is happening, we initiate a modified 2004 protocol. And that is, we start off at least cyclosporin and steroids and the etoposide based on how bad the infection is or if the patient has a co-infection. Often because of the severe cytopenia, the patient is having some sort of gram-negative sepsis also along with this. And that will sort of preclude the use of high-dose etoposide. Now, if this patient is not transplant eligible, actually the transplant eligibility comes in only once the patient is in remission. That's important to remember. It's not like you can rush this patient into a transplant when they have an active HLH going on. You have to give them induction, you have to get them into remission, and once they are either in a partial or complete remission, the patient is a candidate for a transplant. If the patient is overall if we are able to clearly identify that the patient does not have an familial history for this and the patient is having EBV-CMV infection alone, there is a rationale to continue with the entire maintenance of HLH 2004 protocol and leave it at that. But as this question states, it is how to treat a relapsed EBV-CMV infection. Very clearly, in the setting of relapse and EBV-CMV infection, the only correlate, the treatment correlate that improves outcomes is a transplant. So again, once they relapse, we give a relapse protocol either with DEP or any of the other the second line agents that we can consider, including chemotherapy, and bring the patient into remission and subsequently take for an urgent transplant. Actually, there is one drug that I have not talked about, which also can be used in this setting, emapalumab, which is an interferon gamma. I thought it would be too much, but interferon gamma antibody, monoclonal antibody, which has been FDA cleared in, I think, 2018 end, it was cleared for use. So that is a drug that can be considered in the relapsed and even in the upfront setting, of course. But it's a drug that can be considered in those who are transplant ineligible. But I definitely, it's a big conundrum, something that we also face. But I think often this transplant ineligibility is a fluid thing. I'll stop here because there's lots I can talk about here. But there are many case scenarios I can talk about. Where we have faced this and how we have overcome each individual case scenario. It's sort of a case by case basis that we have to go on this. Including trying alternate donor transplants, haploidentical transplants, transplanting from donors who have heterozygous gene mutations, just because they have clinically not ever manifested with the disease. There are many caveats and alternate pathways that we have to take when the ideal, matched sibling donor transplant is not available.
There's one last question. TB with MAS, how long do you suggest steroid treatment?
Yeah, I think the standard thing that we are now suggesting is around 2 months steroids, but this is very, very fluid. We have at least two patients with TB-induced HLH who subsequently 2 months later, when we had done the gene screen, both of them had shown heterozygous perforin gene mutations. And actually now one of them transplanted, one is on the transplant list. But there are a significant number of patients who are obviously HLH with TB presentations without any identified NGS mutations. We advise anywhere between 2 months, anywhere between 4 weeks to 8 weeks of steroid therapy. Of course, it's very important to remember that we don't want to push the steroid to unnecessarily in the setting of TB, especially when there is an underlying possible immunocompromise for whatever reason there might be. So it's a sort of ad hoc decision that has to be taken, but the minimum is 4 weeks. That is as per at least most of the case reports and studies that have been published. There's not too many guidelines on this, but the guidelines that are there suggest anywhere between 4 to 8 weeks.
Thanks, Sushil. Any further questions? Soon, lecture will soon be uploaded on the Department of Medicine YouTube website. So please feel free to access the lecture in the same. Or if you have any doubts, you can mail to medtu@cmcvalue.ac.in. Or you can meet Dr. Sushil in person and ask him also. I think if that's for all, shall we wind up for today? Thanks everyone for joining us.
Thanks so much. Yeah.
And bye. Hi, Dr. G. Thoughts. Thanks, Sushil. I think we'll wind up for today. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks.